Epic family, welcome. So good to see you guys. Let's stand together. And we're going to sing of the love and the grace of Jesus today. He's given us a reason to sing, put a song in our heart. So let's lift it up today. Here we go. We can trust Him.
Down your life, that I would be
sing for all that you've done for me.
Christ.
Enough for us today, it is true that everything that we need is found in Christ, in Christ alone. But I recognize that some of us, as we sing that today, I know it can feel a little bit detached from our reality. I know sometimes doubt creeps in and we think, well, Christ plus something else would give me peace, right? I'm lacking this. And I think you're not alone in that. I just want you to know today that if you're feeling a little disconnected from Jesus is everything that I need, you're not alone. And even his first followers, you know, I was thinking this week about Peter, and he doubted. I mean, Peter, you know, this guy who just was bold as a lion at the end, he caved when Jesus went to the cross. And he denied him. And doubt filled his heart. But he didn't stay that way. And we really need to think about this today as a church, because just a few days later, just as Jesus had said, man, everything changed. Everything changed. And Peter, who was tucking his tail and running when Jesus was arrested, now was bold as a lion. I mean, just could not be stopped. And he's proclaiming the truth with boldness and with authority. Why? Well, he said it in his letter. He said right in the beginning, he's given us a new birth, a fresh start into a living hope through the resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. He's alive. He saw him, and he's proclaiming the hope to all those who would come and be a part of this amazing family that is the family of God, that is filled with the Holy Spirit. And that's us. We're a part of that. So today you get to be invited. You're invited. You are invited into a living hope. It's a hope that will not spoil. It won't fade. It doesn't come and go with the fads. It doesn't come and go with the news. It's a hope that doesn't change, and it's anchored in the person of Jesus Christ. And you can trust him with all of your heart today. So let's sing this song with so much hope today, knowing that he's got us.
Glory to wear my sin and bear my
Jesus, we lift you high, we worship you, and thank you for the confidence that your presence gives us, just to keep leaning in trust, in faith, even to know right now that the work that you've begun, it's yours. You can complete it, you'll carry it out. So just give us more confidence to keep following you closely, to even come close enough to see that you transform everything, you change it all, you make all things new, and you are our hope. We love you and we worship you today. In your name, amen. Amen.
Amen. Would you guys help me in just showing our appreciation to the worship team this morning for leading us? Yeah, and just right off the start, I want to let you know, don't miss September 8th. Online and in the room, 7 p.m., we're going to have a night of prayer and worship where our worship team is going to lead us into the presence of God, and we're going to have time to pray together, so you don't want to miss that. So September 8th, 7 p.m., make sure you mark that down. You guys can go ahead and have a seat. To all of our friends joining us online, we're so glad that you're here today. My name is Lindsay, if we haven't had the chance to meet, and I want to officially welcome you to Epic Church. We are so glad that you're here today. And if you're new to Epic, I want to especially welcome you into our community today. We believe that this is a place where you can find home. There is a place for you here, and so it means so much to us today that you would take the time to come and see and come and experience God and worship with us. So thanks for being here. We do want to help you stay connected. We want to make sure that you have everything you need. So I want to ask you right now to go ahead and take a moment and fill out the Connect card. It's in the seat back in front of you. There's a QR code there. It's online as well. And as you fill this out, if you are new to Epic, let us know. We want a chance to meet you before you go today. We also have a small gift for you, just one way we want to say thank you. So as you fill out that card, when we're done here today, you can bring it to the Next Steps area on your way out. Again, our team will be there, and it would be just such a privilege for us to be able to say hi and to know your name before you go. Today, we are 2 weeks away from our Next Steps lunch, and so I want to invite you into that. If you want to be a part of what God is doing in this church, we want you to know that when you become a part of Epic, you become a part of our family here. And in every great family, every single person is known and is connected. And every person gets the chance to receive the benefits of being in the family, as well as serving each other in love. And so at the Next Steps lunch, you're going to hear from our team more about the vision, values of our church, and how you can step further into being a part of this family. So that's September 12th. You can let us know you want to come, and we will make sure to send you a reminder before then. Before the Next Steps lunch, right now, today, in this moment, you have a chance to stay connected to the community by joining one of our groups. Our groups are here to give you a chance to meet other people. You see all these people here, there's people online. Groups give you the chance to actually know someone's name and for someone to know your name. Gives you the chance to grow in your faith. It also gives you the chance to be cared for. If there's a way that you can be encouraged, prayed for, celebrated, all of that happens in our Epic groups. So our groups will start meeting the week of September 12th, but we don't want you to miss anything. So go ahead and reserve your spot in one of our groups today. You can do that online, epicsf.com/groups, and you're going to see a variety of groups, a variety of topics, a variety of stages of life. And so we are so confident that we have a group for you. If there's a way we can help you find one, don't hesitate to ask. Let us know. We would love to help you do that. Today, as we continue in the series, When Money Talks, we have the great privilege in just a few moments to hear from Pastor Ben and Minnie Lee as they share their experiences and share from the scripture. So before they come, we have a chance right now to settle ourselves, to take a moment and invite God in, because we believe that God can, will, and wants to speak to you today. So let's invite him in this moment and ask him to do that. Holy Spirit, would you come into this place, God? We believe that you want to speak to us today. We believe that you will speak to us. So God, we ask, as you're speaking today, God, would you open up our minds? Would you open up our hearts to be able to hear from you? God, and when we hear your voice, would you give us the courage and the faith today to take a step with you, God? Would you give us the faith that we need, God, to take a step in making sure that our money, our resources don't have power over us, God? We surrender this time to you, and we ask that you would come. In Jesus' name, amen.
If you're not moving along with that, I don't know what's going to happen with my message. I'm looking for some feedback this morning, but if you don't have that, I don't even know. Hey, who wants to know their future? I know. We can't know our futures. But friends, listen, just because we can't know everything about our future doesn't mean we can't know anything about our future. So much in our life, if you think about it, like we already are making sure that certain areas in our lives are spoken for. Would you agree? Think about it like this. Every time you put an appointment on your calendar, you're making sure that that date specifically and at that specific time, it is already spoken for. And you're like, no, Ben, I don't actually make most of my appointments. Well, that's a different message. But you're making sure when you put something on. Parents, when you decide to have children, are you making sure that so much about your future is already spoken for? You do know this, right? So much about the future is already spoken for. Shauna and I were with some friends, and we've been journeying with these friends a long time. I was a college pastor to this friend and then met his wife here at Epic. We did their wedding, and they had a baby earlier this month. And so going to visit that little guy, he's so cute, but I'm just looking at him and going, yes, so much about your future is already spoken for. As Lindsay just mentioned, if you join an Epic group this fall, in fact, I would encourage you to do it today. What we're doing when we join an Epic group is making sure that so much about our future is already spoken for. So why not get in the game today? Make sure that your future care, your future relationships, your future spiritual growth is already spoken for. And anybody besides me, just so grateful, especially going back to that first song today, that because of Jesus offering his life for us, so much about our future is already spoken for. And can we just, Seth, thank you for how you led us, just knowing, like, let's not forget this. So much about our future is already spoken for, and that's what we want to talk about today as I have the privilege of teaching, team teaching with Minnie Lee in the second installment of When Money Talks. When Money Talks, and here's specifically what we want to ask you today. Like, do you have a plan for making sure that any of your future income is already spoken for? Let me ask it more specifically in this way. Do you have an actual plan for being generous, or are you taking a wait-and-see approach? Everyone in our world today really buys into this wait-and-see approach with everything, right? It's been one of the most disheartening things for me to watch how the world's kind of unfolded in this. I see so many people actually going into marriage with a wait-and-see approach. I'm going to make sure that I've got to clean out. I'm in, but not completely. Like, part of my heart is back here. And I just want you to know, like, when it comes to generosity, I get why you might think the wait-and-see approach is the only approach that you should actually have. I mean, let's be honest. We have no idea how much money we're going to make for the rest of our lives, do we? Who has any clue what expenses will arise over the next 10 or 20 or 30 years? I mean, Ben, let's be honest. I'm not sure how my investments are going to do. So how in the world could I have a generosity plan rather than a wait-and-see approach because I just have so much uncertainty about my future? Well, just so you know, my future is uncertain as well. And yet, here's what I found out, and I'll ask it this way. What if we can make a generosity plan for our future that doesn't involve us having to know everything about our future? Isn't this good news? Like, what if you can actually make a plan without the knowledge that you and I will never have? What if we can make a generosity plan about our future without having to know everything about our future? Here's what I believe about you. Tell me if I'm wrong, though. It'll be an embarrassing thing to yourself, but tell me if I'm wrong. What I believe about most of us in this room is we actually want to be generous. What I believe about most of you watching online right now is that you actually want to be generous, and many, and I think that's super commendable. We said last week that your relationship with money, it always starts in the heart. And so if that's your heart today, I just want to say kudos to you. That is a first step. It is a necessary step. But here's the thing. Without a plan, our intentions of being generous will not make us generous people. Can I get an amen? Like, I mean, anybody else besides me, you've heard this from me before, but I am a gold medalist several times over in the Olympics when it comes to good intentions. But my intentions aren't enough for me. I need a plan. Guys, I intend to wake up very early every single morning. But without a plan called an alarm clock or a dog, I do not wake up early when I want to. Anybody else? Like, somebody's like, no, Ben, it's just my body. I was like, all right, you're being arrogant about your biological rhythm. I don't even know what that is. But I intend to get up early. Without a plan called an alarm clock, I don't tend to get up early. I intend to get in shape. Anybody intend to get in shape? But without a plan called daily exercise, my intentions are not going to make this body tone. And some of you are like, Ben, yeah, that's pretty obvious. Guys, the same is true with generosity. I intend to be generous, but if I don't have a plan, my intentions at the end of my life, I will not be able to look back and go, wow, I was so generous. I will be like, man, I really meant to. Anybody just tired of meaning to do things in your life? Not just at this topic, but like, I'm just tired of meaning to do things. I want to actually do the things, right? I want to set my heart and my mind on an intention, and then I want to discipline myself, whatever it looks like, health, parenting, marriage, all the things, so that I can move into and actually execute on the things that I've been honestly intending to do for a while. We did some yard work yesterday. You're like, Ben, that's really commendable. Like, no, it was like yard work for the first time in 2 years for me, okay? But I meant to do it earlier. I did. And so what Minnie and I want to do is launch into week two of When Money Talks, and we're calling this message Spoken For. Spoken For. If you have a scripture on you, we're in Luke chapter 12. I want you to stand with me. I believe Jesus wants to speak into this for us. I know you're having fun. I just can't tell behind your mask, so I'm just assuming you're having a blast right there. In Luke chapter 12, verses 13 through 21, I want you to hear the words from Jesus because he wants to speak into this. He wants to share some things with us that we might not even realize are happening in our hearts and in our minds and in our lives. And here's what went down. Someone in the crowd, verse 13, said to Jesus, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." Jesus replied, "Man, who appointed me a judge or an arbiter between you?" Then he said to them, "Watch out. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed. Life does not consist in an abundance of possessions." And he told them this parable. The ground of a certain rich man yielded an abundant harvest. He thought to himself, "What shall I do? I have no place to store my crops." He must have lived in a small studio in San Francisco. Then he said, "This is what I'll do. Aha! I will tear down my barns, multiple barns, and build bigger ones. What else would I do? And there I will store my surplus grain. And I'll say to myself, 'You have plenty of grain laid up for many years. Take life easy. Eat, drink, and be merry.' But God said to him, 'You fool. This very night your life will be demanded from you. Then who will get what you have prepared,'" key phrase here, "'for yourself? This is how it will be with whoever." And we're all in that whoever, in case you're wondering. Remember, God so loved the world that whoever, that includes us, but so does this one. "This is how it will be with whoever stores up things for themselves, but is not rich toward God." You may be seated. I think God's going to do some things in our hearts, just in this message. Many and I have been so excited to share this with you because of the journey that God has taken us on, both in the time before we knew each other and as we've been able to lead our church together in this way, and also many someone who I go to for my own personal financial wisdom for different things. And here's what I'll ask you, and you don't have to answer out loud, but do you know who thinks they're generous? Almost everyone. Really? Because they remember the one time they helped the lady across the street. You know who thinks they're greedy? Practically no one. Practically no one. And yet Jesus knows something. Remember, whenever we get warnings from the scripture, 2 weeks ago in the Holy Spirit, remember, be careful how you live. Whenever you get those kinds of warnings, it's because your default is something else. And what Jesus knows is what we all need to know, and it's this: greed is the default for the human heart. Like, Ben, I don't know if that's true. Let's just go in that epic kids room and find that little 2-year-old boy with 8 cars in his hand. And watch his little friend, watch her playing with a different car, and he's going to be like, "I've got to have that one." And you're like, "Ben, yeah, but that's just for 2-year-olds, is it?" Guys, this is what happened with original sin. We think there's a lot going on in the Garden of Eden, and you're absolutely right. But think about greed as the original sin. God creates Adam, then he creates Eve, and he puts them in this Garden of Eden, and it is so abundant. God's not a restricting God. He's an abundant God. He's an abundant God. Does he put us off limits on some things? Absolutely. If you focus there, God might be a killjoy in your mind, but you need to go, no, he's given me so much. I mean, Adam and Eve, you can have breakfast at the plum tree. You can do a date night at the pear tree. You can afternoon snack at the apple tree. I don't know about organic peanut butter with that. But here's the thing, that this one is off limits. So they have all of these things, and they're like, "We want that one," because we, by default, always want more. We always want We always want more. I want to ask you a question. It's not a money question. It's a big 30,000-foot question. It's a question that you need to give weight to. It's a question that you need to write down. The question is this: what are you making your life all about? And I hope, and I do a lot of this work, both personally, I do it with other people, we need to come up with the kind of vision statement that's designed to figure out what we want our lives to be about. It needs to be inspiring to you, and it needs to encapsulate. You need to be able to remember what that is. But what you need to know is that a great vision statement, just like good intentions, it's not going to mean that you live that out. When I ask people all the time, tell me what your life is about, tell me what your life is about, they're like, it's this. I want to be generous. I want to be a great leader. I want to be an amazing husband. And I'm like, that is awesome. But guys, if you want to know what your life is all about, here's what you do. How are you spending your time? How are you spending your money? What are you doing with any little or big influence that you have? And how are you living into, or are you living out of, the calling that God has on your life? If you want to know what your life is all about, those are the kinds of questions you should begin asking. And right from this text, I want to say this with as much passion and conviction as I can. And I want to say with as much truth as I can. You were made for more than building bigger barns for yourself. You were made for more. If no one's told you that at the office lately, and they probably haven't, I want you to know this. If your parents didn't put this into you, they know you have to major in this and you have to get into that, right? You ever had that? And what I want to tell you is you were made for more. Building bigger barns for yourself is a tiny mission. God has given the design to your life that is a grand mission. And here's what you have to know. Any mission that has you at the center of it is a small mission. Any mission that has you or me at the center of it, that's such a tiny mission. And I want to get enveloped in this grand mission of God. I've got this short time on earth. So God, what do you want to use my short 60 or 70 or 80 or 90 or maybe 100 years? How do you want to leverage it for the sake of the thing that's going to be on forever? You were made for more, but here's the good news. And you maybe have never heard a pastor say this. God is cool with you making tons of money. Tweet it if you want to. God is so good with you making tons of money. God gives good gifts, but his gifts make bad gods. Do you see Jesus chastising the man in the parable for the size of his harvest? Anybody? I'm going to give you a turn, but I'm in it right now. Anybody see Jesus going, I can't believe the harvest was that large? There's nothing wrong with it. But what strikes me about this parable is that this guy, not until he had an abundant harvest, did he even start asking the what am I going to do with it question. The guy's rich. He wasn't condemned for his wealth. The guy already has multiple barns. He wasn't condemned. You're like, Ben, which one of those was a vacation barn? I don't know. But he wasn't condemned by Jesus. He just had no plan for what he was going to do with whatever happened in his future. And what we want to do is arrest you in your tracks today so that you begin to ask the question, what am I going to do with it, before you get the thing that you're going to do something with. I would urge you to do this. Do it in your marriage. Do it with how you're going to raise your children. Jesus did it with us. He didn't wait till we got here and go, oh man, what are we going to do with that guy? I mean, maybe he did. He's like, I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to give my life for her. I'm going to give my life for him. I'm going to build this thing in San Francisco. We're going to actually survive and thrive coming out of COVID. I know what I'm going to do. He's thinking ahead of time, and I want you and I to begin thinking ahead of time about what we're going to do. The guy doesn't even ask the question. So here's what I urge you to do. Predecide what you're going to do with whatever God gives you in the future. Predecide what you're going to do with whatever God gives you in the future. Pre-decide it. Guys, we have plans for everything. Everything. At work, you're making plans for how to deliver great customer service. Right? When you go on a vacation, you've heard me say this, I have more fun oftentimes planning our vacations than I have going on the vacations. Hey, Ben, you're weird. I am, but I love it. I love it all. What if I told you, and you might not believe me, but you can have as much fun planning your generosity as you do planning your vacation? If you get the heart thing we talked about last week in the right place. 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and chapter 9 are where you get a ton from the Apostle Paul to the Corinthian Christians about how generosity works. And I'm going to give you those two reference points. I'll give you a few scriptures out of those today. But if you go to 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7, there's one I really want to highlight so that you get a clear picture of who God is, why he's up to, what he's up to, why he's asking us to do, what he's asking us to do. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7, and then we'll break down this entire verse. Here's what he says. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give. Don't you love this part? Not reluctantly. Anybody tired of doing stuff reluctantly? Or under compulsion? Not a have to. For God loves a cheerful giver. And you know who else loved a cheerful giver? A cheerful giver. They've discovered something. They've discovered something that runs counterintuitive to the way that they used to think. And they've discovered something that runs counterintuitive to the way the world works. Let's just break that down. The first phrase we've got to break down is each of you. Paul's like, all of you. This is where he's invoking one of our nine epic values. Everyone plays a part. Each of you, not just the rich, not the middle class, not the poor, not those who've been in the community for 5 years, not those who've been walking with Jesus for a decade. Each of you, it's an all play. It's how the vision of churches move forward. It's true in Corinth. It's true in San Francisco. And our cities have a lot in common, but that's a whole different sermon. Each of you, give what you have decided in your heart to give. We said last week the conversation with money starts in the heart, but it has to get out of your heart at some point, doesn't it? Like, oh, in my heart, I think, listen, man, your heart's not making a difference in my marriage. I need you to bring it, you know? I need to get out of your heart and into your life. He says, give what you have decided. Paul is making the assumption that he has pre-deciding Christians in Corinth. Just give what you've decided to give. Guys, if we made front-end decisions, then when we got to all these moments, we're like, I don't know what to do now. No, we decided what we're going to do. Until God leads us in a different direction, we want to pre-decide. So he's like, do what you've decided in your heart. And then I love this point. He's like, don't do it under compulsion. Oh, my goodness. Don't do it reluctantly. God loves a cheerful giver. Here's what you need to hear. And some of you, this is the whole point for today. God wants giving to be a joyful get-to for us, not a guilt-ridden have-to. And so if it's been the latter for you, you've missed his heart. And what we want to encourage you to do is like let these truths sink into your heart. God wants it to be a joyful get-to for us. So, Ben, do I really have to pre-decide if I'm going to be generous? I think you really do. Like, Ben, how do you know? Because I've lived long enough. And I know what happens with my spur-of-the-moment decisions. Anybody else? Most of your regrets are spur-of-the-moment decisions? Yeah, so I really think you have to decide ahead of time. I mean, what strikes me about the man in the parable is that he didn't have a plan. He hadn't decided ahead of time. So when he got more, he thought it was more for him. What else do I do? Like, I have this, but now I don't have enough space to hold the newest harvest. So the only way to make space for the harvest isn't to ask whose house is empty. It's to build a bigger house. And he misses this amazing opportunity to be rich toward God and toward other people. He misses, I think, like this great opportunity to be rich toward God and to be rich toward other people. And he just misses this opportunity. And guys, what I sit with people all the time and realize is that they've missed opportunities, not just with this topic. And I was like, let's stop missing opportunities. Remember 2 weeks ago, last Sunday in the Holy Spirit, make the most of every opportunity. And here's what I know in our epic church community. Like, Ben, how do you know this? Because I am privileged to information. I know people. I hear stories, okay? Here's what I know. In our epic church community, some of you aren't sure how you're going to pay September rent, and others of you are on the brink of making tens of millions of dollars, if not more. And most of us are somewhere in between. I don't care where you are in that journey, but I want to beg you, prioritize investing in the mission of God over merely building bigger barns. Prioritize. One of the things I love, and just so you know, you're like, oh, I bet you guys make it. No, what I love in our household is when one of my kids says, hey, Dad, can you help me set up this PushPay app? I'm like, your father's old school. I don't even have the app, but yes, we can get you set up so that they could give their $4, their 10% of what they had made towards that week or whatever the case, not chores, not like really chores, Ben? I'll come work for you. No, not chores at our house, but things that they receive. And I love that conversation. You see, this man in the story, he was convinced of what so many of us are convinced of, and it's this. If I get more for me, that brings greater joy. If I give some of my more to you, that will make me sorrowful. And what it reminds me of is a great scripture to learn is Proverbs 11, 24 and 25, which say this. Tell me if I get it wrong. One gives freely, yet gains even more. Another withholds unduly, but comes to poverty. A generous person will prosper. Whoever refreshes others will be refreshed. what we believe is if I hold on to it, I gain even more, right? If I let go of it, I come to poverty. Or if I refresh you, where's my refreshment? And that's where you back into last week and go, no, the Lord is my shepherd. I can refresh Atul, and I can refresh Rachel, and I can refresh Natalie, and I can refresh Ben, and I don't lose my refreshment. And what if it's in refreshing you that God refreshes me? Like, Ben, is that work like that? Just all throughout the scriptures, Jesus said, hey, as you do it to each other, this is how your Heavenly Father does it to you. If you withhold forgiveness, right? This is the whole thing. So here's the question. It's a great question. How much should we give if we want to be rich? Like, oh, we're one of those churches. Yes, we're not. I've got to be honest. In the original notes, as many and I were going over it, here's the question I had. How much should we give if you want to be rich toward God? And she's like, Ben, take out that toward God phrase. How much do we need to give if we want to be rich? And it begins, of course, with us redefining the word rich. I'm going to give that to you later when we talk about the centrality of Christianity, so don't go anywhere. If we want to be rich, how much should we give? Well, you're like, Ben, I don't know. Here's our issue again. I don't know how much I should give because I don't know how much I'm going to get. Guys, here's the genius of the way Scripture speaks about generosity. It's always in proportion to or a percentage of what we've been given. So when you get to the Old Testament, before the law, for all you scholars out there, Abraham gives the tithe. Tithe equals 10%. It shows up in the law. Jesus references it. And then people are like, Ben, I don't know about the tithe in the New Testament. Is that something I have to do? No, you got the whole question wrong. You tell me, Keller would say, like, have you got less revelation on the back end of Jesus' death and resurrection or more? No one in the New Testament is commended for generosity who gives 10%. No one. Not the widow. Not the Macedonian church. Not Jesus. But if that baseline of a tithe seems like too much of a gap from where you are today to there, guys, start somewhere. But pre-decide and tie it proportionally. This is what I love. 2 Corinthians 8:12 says, for if the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. So being generous for you is not going to be the same as being generous for me. Does that make sense? So the question is like, well, who's generous? A person who gives $200 this year or a person who gives $20,000 this year? You don't know unless I give you the variable, right? Let's assume the person giving $200 is going to make $2,000 this year. The person giving $20,000 is going to make $2 million. Who's generous? Friends, one gave 10% and probably was very costly 10%. The other gave 1%. Generous? No. Sean and I have been married just over 20 years. December will be 21. And in our marriage, we've gotten a lot of things wrong. Okay, let's be honest. In our marriage, I have gotten a lot of things wrong. But this is one I'm so grateful to God and to her that from day one of our marriage, we've gotten right. When we were making nothing. You're like, Ben, nothing? No, like really nothing. Thankfully, we had a rent of $345 a month. When we were making nothing, we decided that we would give 10% of everything that came into us to the local church we were part of. And no, we weren't working at a church back then. And we've done that for all 20 years. And then about 10 years ago, just after Epic started, we decided that we would go up on top of that 10%. And you know how many regrets we have? None. You know what we've seen God do in our hearts and in the mission that he's granted us to be a part of, both here at Epic and in adoption stories and in the lives of families in Uganda and the lives of families in Africa and in the Tenderloin, we've been able to make some differences in the lives of some of you who needed help along the way. It has been a joy-filled journey of generosity. But I'm not the only one who's had a joy-filled journey of generosity. Many, why don't you come share some of the amazing things that God's taught you and teach us?
So I got serious about planning my finances in 2012, which was when I started learning about managing money God's way. I mean, before that, I was like, I didn't know there was a managing money God's way. I just thought there was just my way. And let me tell you, my way was one big hot mess because it was all about me. What am I going to get? What am I going to pay for? Where can I live? What can I drive? What can I wear? And it didn't matter how much I made. In fact, I realized that the more I made, I mean, thank God, God has blessed me with that, but the more I made, it didn't necessarily bring me financial health. So my simple reason for budgeting at that time was to, wow, when I start, giving 10% of my income, as I got to know God and I said I'll follow him, wow, how am I going to make my numbers work? Okay, so far we've been talking a lot about our hearts. Hey, but what is God's heart? What is God's heart for us when it comes to money? Is it just all about giving 10% or give up everything and follow me? I mean, if that's the only two narratives we have, no wonder we feel uncomfortable when it comes to giving. So recently, I read Deuteronomy 14, 22 to 29, and I realized that when I read them before, I was reading it with my own bias. I discovered something this time that I had not seen before. Maybe it's just me. And in this passage, God gives two main tithing instructions to the Israelites. And just one thing to note before we get into it is that Deuteronomy is all about God's law, and God gave his law to the Israelites. Why? To help them live as freed people, because they were slaves for 400 years. So let's keep that in mind. So the first thing he says is to set aside a tenth of all that they produce. And then what does he say to do with it? We'll see the passage on the screen. He says, eat the tithe of the grain, new wine, olive oil, all those things in the presence of the Lord your God. What, like I thought before, when we set aside, bring it to the Lord, it gets stored in the tabernacle. But here God says, no, I want you to bring it. I want you to eat it before me, enjoy it. And then he even makes the special accommodations for people who are too far away to travel to the place he designated, or who just harvested too much. Nothing wrong with that, like Ben said, and just has too much to carry. He's like, oh, you know what? Sell that where you are. Just bring the money and buy whatever you want to enjoy it. I was like, wow, I didn't know that before. And the second thing he talks about is, hey, also don't forget my priests, the Levites, the orphans, foreigners, and widows. He's saying, hey, provide those who don't have other means to provide for themselves and for those who are in a vulnerable place who literally have nothing. So the result of that is, it's all in this passage still. So the result of that is, number one, we learn to revere the Lord our God always, verse 23. Right? I mean, if when we eat and rejoice and we think about the Lord, we set aside something for him, we're going to think of him more and we're going to be able to, love him more, revere him. Number two, everyone comes and eats and is satisfied. Like, I know in modern day church, we don't come and eat all the time. We do sometimes here and there, but this is the way I see it. Everything you see here, enjoy here, everything we experience, even during the week through groups, this is all because you gave, our community gave. And I hope that when we come and leave, we just feel like, hey, we're filled up, we're satisfied, and we actually like seeing each other. I hope. Yes. And third, the Lord our God blesses us in all the work we do. Hey, don't we all want that? I want it. So this is all consistent with what Paul writes to Timothy in 1 Timothy 6:17. And Pastor Ben mentioned this last week too, but I want to keep remind us that God really wants to give us for our enjoyment. So he's richly providing, not just like providing, he's richly providing for our enjoyment. And it's also consistent with Leviticus 19:9-10, which has become like one of my favorite verses lately. He says, when you reap the harvest of your land, do not reap to the very edges of your field or gather the gleanings of your harvest. Leave them for the poor and the foreigners. And then he says, I am the Lord your God. Why would he say that at the end? Because he's like, hey, remember, I'm your God. I provide for you. So stop trying to gather everything and store it up in your barn. So he's like, hey, he's asking his people, give towards the Lord, still enjoy it in the front end, and help others in the back end. It's like a, you know, two bookends right there. So what else about God's heart? He wants us to have what we need with what he gives us. In 1 Timothy 5:8, you'll see it on the screen. Yeah, he says we are to provide for our family and our relatives. And I know like the language in the verse is pretty strong, but we get the point. So this is what I'm budgeting. We're budgeting the heart of God. And I know it sounds like so, like whatever, right? But we really are, and we don't think budgeting as a spiritual exercise, but I'm here to tell you that it can be, and it has been for me. So this is what my budgeting is to reflect. Number one, I set aside 10% for my faith community, right? So if I contribute to my faith community and my community is enriched by it, I in turn get enriched by it too because I belong here. Number two, yeah, I want to use my income to provide for myself and others. And when I say provide, it also means like saving some for the future of, you know, future unknown things. And because I don't have my direct family, my own family to feed, like I can kind of expand that. And that's really fun. And third, leave some margin for those who are in need. We don't know who in our community is going to need something. And I want to make sure that, like, not only have, like, the financial margin, but, like, in my heart. Because if my heart's closed up, I'm like, I don't know if I want to help. So I not only want to budget this monthly and yearly, but I also want to kind of have a longer-term view by thinking ahead a little bit. And I know so far I've talked about this as if it's easy. Like, one, two, three, this is how you do it. But for those of you who are in my financial wisdom groups or any different workshops, you know it came only after just years of, like, painful change in my heart, like the way I look at things, the way I think about things, and just years of commitment. And really, to be honest, my heart started from a place of obedience. I did it because God said it, not necessarily because I felt so generous. I'm like, oh, I'm a Christian, now I can be generous. And I know that contradicts with what Ben said before, like, hey, we don't want to be have-to people, we want to be get-to people. But I do believe that, and I know that because I've lived it, when we start in a have-to place, God can transform our hearts to a get-to place. And you know, we were doing the Holy Spirit series, and it's not over. This is going to be ongoing. Let's not do this without the Holy Spirit, because without the Holy Spirit, we can't hear him. We can't know his heart. We can't do this because this stuff's hard. Letting go of our finances, it's hard and it's scary. Where am I? Okay, I'm looking at my notes here. So when I obeyed, God met me there. And after that, it took about 3 years of just dedication and discipline. But with that, my relationship with God grew. And I realized, wow, budgeting is not just to, like, make numbers work. Budgeting actually is to become generous. You know, that's what God has for us when it comes to, like, our financial freedom. So these have been my three main goals, my finances every year, and it will always be. And I just wanted to note that these goals could be different for each of you because I think we all have different relationships with our money. Let me go over mine, and then maybe I can talk about some other examples. Yeah, number one, I plan to give away more every year. And I don't like ambiguity, so when I say more, I was like, oh, I need to define that. So I said, okay, I'm going to give half a percentage point more every year. Doesn't matter what I make. Number two, live within my means. Number three, become and stay debt-free. Two and three go really, really close together. For me, living within my means was a big thing because I couldn't before. I was too focused on acquiring things because I had to cover up whatever, you know, shame I was feeling in my life. And I thought, if I have more, I'll be better. And that resulted in a lot of debt. But your relationship could be different. You could be like, no, I have no problem not spending. But I have talked with people who have said, you know what, I feel like I'm saving too much. I don't know how to, like, free it up. to other people. So yeah, just think about, oh, what are your goals? And yeah, all of this positioned me to become free more and more, be more generous more and more. And I can't believe that I'm even saying that, because I know I'm not a generous person. I wasn't born a generous person. And I'd just be really transparent. By mid-2015, my income was probably 40% or less. It's not just because I started working at Epic. It's not that. I had other reasons before. I had, like, was a medical leave, so I couldn't, you know, work as much, all that. But regardless of that, I had given more than I had ever given before. I became debt-free. And you know what? I wasn't feeling like I was lacking. I was very content. And I realized, wow, I don't have to live with all these things that I thought I needed. This is no small miracle, guys. And actually, this is the area where I experience God's miracle the most, almost day to day. And I still don't comprehend how it all happened mathematically, to be honest, but I think this is what God's economy is like. His principles tower over otherworldly truths. Okay, and fast forwarding a little bit, now that I've been immensely blessed with more resources in my life, hey, I have to confess, my will to control that creeps up on me, and it happens more than I'd like. And that's why I know that greed is our default, not the other way around. But because of my relationship with the Lord, because of the discipline, and by His grace, I can hear Him, and because I know He's faithful, I can say yes. And speaking of saying yes, we would love for you to say yes to something today. And something I said yes to about 9 years ago, which started this whole thing. We call it the 90-Day Generosity Challenge. I know I sound like a salesperson right now, but I dare to say that this is a 90-Day Faith Challenge. So in front of you in the seat back, you'll find a card. It looks like this. And this is where you can sign up. Or if you're like, I don't want to touch anything, there is a way to do it digitally. You can text 90 days to 313131. And you'll get a link where you can sign up digitally. So the generosity challenge, basically, it's asking you to just share with us, hey, number one, I want to take this challenge for 90 days. I want to give a percentage of my income. If you're also considering, oh, maybe you want to increase, like just, yeah, take that next step, you can mark that decision here too. And the second is I will attend the budgeting workshop on September 7th. You ask, what is this budgeting workshop? Well, since we don't have time to kind of go over the details on how to budget, I am going to host an online workshop September 7th. That's a Tuesday at 7 p.m., We want to help you, and this is one of the ways we want to help you. I hope you sign up and see what God has for us when it comes to budgeting. Who would have thought? And yeah, second way we want to help you is through just encouraging you to just try automated giving. When I did this, 9 years ago, 8 years ago, I felt like, oh, this is so transactional and dry. But you know what? I also realized that doing that is going to help me not renege on my commitment to the Lord when I said, okay, I'm giving a percentage. And we want to make the execution part easy for you, because deciding to give is actually very hard. The third way we want to help you is when you sign up, we want to keep in touch with you for the next 90 days. Just a way to encourage you along the way. I want to hear from you guys, like, hey, what are the challenges? What are the prayers that you need? And any cool stories that you might have. And we want to do this. We want to do all this, not because I love to work, like, create work for myself and create work for the team, but because, what we want to see is really our community coming together and our finances reflecting the heart of God. And then what happens to us is that we live in financial freedom that we never experienced before. And we don't get to experience that until we do it. Yeah, so we want to invite you in on that. And yeah, we are spoken for by God. You know, and who are we spoken for by? God is the most infinitely generous, and he has infinite resources. That's who we're spoken for by.
So good. Stay right here. We're not done. We're about to bring this. Hey, two things I just felt in that moment, like as you were teaching us so much gold, two things I really want you to know. If you want to continue to kind of soften your heart in this area. Number one, we don't want something from you. We want something for you. Number two, Epic's in great financial shape. We're on pace, even with COVID and everything, have our best financial year ever. So I want you to know that. And praise God. We want this for you. The lights being on this week, they're not in jeopardy. Where we want to root this, though, is in the generosity of Jesus. Let me give you 2 Corinthians 8, 9. It's crazy because this is a scripture that's right in the middle of a passage on giving. But listen, if you're new to Christianity, you found this online gathering or you're here in the room, just here, this is the heart of who Jesus is. He says this, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was what? Yet for your sake he became so that you through his poverty might become..." You miss the heart of God. You'll miss everything. Aren't you glad he pre-decided? Before he knew what I was like and what you were like? Before he watched me mess this up in some grand way? No, he pre-decided. When he didn't know all the ways, when I hadn't been born yet, though he foreknew me, he made a way to be generous so that people like many and I and so many of you whose story we know would come to know him. And we said that generosity, it's got to get out of our heart and into his life. Into our lives. Well, for Jesus, it got out of his heart, for God so loved the world that he gave. It got into his life. And for him, it meant that it had to get into his death. And for whatever reason, he thought, like, you're worth it. You're worth it. And so really two questions today. Number one, have you received the rich generosity from Jesus? Like, do you know what he's done for you? And does that make any difference at all? Because we're not looking to move your money. We're looking to move your heart. And so we don't even want to consider question two if we haven't considered question one. And question two, guys, as people who are spoken for, we're going to get an entrustment. And I want you just to go to the end of your life for one moment. A couple things we pull from the scriptures, if you think about today's story and other things we know. Do you want to hear, hey, you had an opportunity to be rich toward God and you weren't? Or do you want to hear what I am aiming my life at and what she's aiming her life at? Well done, good and faithful servant. We have a chance to make a difference in this community, in our city. God has been dropping fresh vision into my heart, and I've been sharing with so many people. The next 5 years, I think, just buckle up. I think God has just been unlocking some things that we've been thinking about for a while, and I cannot wait to see. And so I will gladly personally give to this vision and challenge and encourage us to do the same. Let's pray. Would you guys go ahead and stand as our worship team comes? For starters, if you've never received the generosity, just imagine that there's a God in heaven, if you've never been told that or you've doubted that. And looking down through history, made a pre-decision that giving his life for us would be a great decision. If you've never just set in that, today is your day. Today, by faith, go, Jesus, if you gave everything you had, so that I could have this rich life on earth, this abundant life on earth, and this rich life for all of eternity, I want it. And if that's you, would you just lift a hand so we can just pray for you? Like, today I'm placing my faith in Jesus. Today I want to receive the generosity that the God of heaven, awesome, has given me. And then for the rest of us, we'll talk more about this next week, but like, do you trust him? Do you think that his heart is good? Do you think he can take care of you? Do you think he will be faithful in the future like he has been in your past? And for some of us, it's time to step into this challenge, to go, hey, I'm going to have this renewed decision. I've got a kind of job. I'm not even sure about my job. I don't know what's coming in the future. I don't know what's happening in the fourth quarter, even this year. But I'm going to predetermine, God, that you can have this. There's something freeing about a predetermined yes. So God, come and move and remind us what we want most of all is you, Lord. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's worship. I hope that God will draw our hearts through the lyrics of this song.
I'm caught up in your presence. Oh, I just wanna sit here at your feet. I'm caught up in this holy moment. I never wanna leave. Oh, I'm not here for blessings. Jesus, you don't owe me anything. And more than anything that you can do, I just want you. Oh, and I'm sorry when I'm just gone through the motions. I'm sorry when I just sang another song. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. Oh, and I'm sorry when I've come with my agenda. I'm sorry when I forgot that you're enough. Take me back to where we started. I open up my heart to you. And I just want you and nothing else. And nothing else. Nothing else will do.
So it starts in our heart. Nothing else will do. I don't know about you guys, but it's easy to think of all the other things that would help me out. And certainly, it's not that God doesn't give other things, right? But we seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. And that's what we're doing with our giving today.